let me then introduce the next presenter, Vasil Kolev from Bulgaria.
Yeah.
And his lecture about file encryption for untrusted remote file system. Vasil, here you go.
Good morning. Welcome to my boring talk. So, this is called file encryption for untrusted remote file systems, but so as every talk it has to start with a very profound quote. So cryptography minimizes trust, basically. This is what I'm going to talk about, why is it important and how do we do that trust minimization. This is as applied as possible. I mean, this I'm going to speak about stuff that you apply directly, that you use directly. There will be almost no mathematics involved, but there's some word stuff and there's some coding, which I don't know if I should call code or puzzles. You'll see later. So, you probably need to know what these four letter acronyms mean to understand this talk, but I'll try to explain as much as possible while I'm talking. Mostly you need to know what AES, RSA, SHA-1 is, and especially what block cipher modes are, because we use those a lot later. So, this is a boring slide. We're a company called PeakCloud. So we do cloud storage properly. Now, why do we do this at all? I mean, we're an Eastern European company with servers in the States. Does anybody trust us? You're right, you shouldn't. We don't want you to trust us, but we want the services to be used because we need to live from something. And this is the reason we're doing this at all. And because requiring too much trust is a bad idea. I mean, probably a lot of you downloaded some pictures in the last 2 weeks. You know which pictures I'm talking about, I think. Somebody lied. So, I'm going to talk about three things. An encrypted file transfer service, a peer-to-peer protocol, and a file system level encryption. These are the things we did with crypto, which would be interesting how you actually apply cryptography in the real world and why it sucks. And so in all of the things, services we use these very basic known primitives, ciphers and hash functions, because we have to be cross-platform, we have to run on a lot of weird devices, and there's not much choice. I mean, we cannot use SAUS, CHARGE, stuff like this because it's not available. It's not implemented, for example, in the Windows crypto libraries or in macOS or in some weird, stupid devices like mobile phones. So, we start with this transfer service. A note. All the things I'm going to talk about, the sources are publicly available on GitHub in peak.com, and I've put some notes on exactly which files you can just see the cryptography. It's extremely pointless to run a cryptography-based service without providing people the source code to audit. Because there's no reason to trust anyone that they're not going to give away your files, and there's even less reason to trust people that say we use cryptography and provide no proof at all. So yeah, sources. And you can also see that there is the URL to the service, which you can play with. Now, basically what the service does, you give it a password, you think of a password, you give it your email, some other people's emails, some files, it encrypts them, stores the files on our systems, and sends a message to the remote site, sends an email to the remote site. The recipients can just open the emails, and if they know the password, they can open the files. That's it. This is an extremely simple service. I said probably journalists can use it. It's a very, very important point. And this is how simple services should look like. Now, this is done all in JavaScript. JavaScript sucks. Browsers suck. Creations of Satan to torment people. Developers also, not people, so yeah. So this is all in JavaScript. We're using the Stanford JavaScript crypto library for the primitives, for the basic implementation of ciphers and everything, because because they know how to write this. It's a very nasty thing to write ciphers, so we prefer to use something. And then we use ASGCM, the Galois counter mod. I put a separate slide for it because it's very, very nice construction. So basically what this is, it turns the cipher into a stream cipher. It just encrypts something. It encrypts with the key an IV, which is an initialization vector, plus the offset, and then XORs this with the input data. So basically you're just encrypting something else and storing it with the input data. This requires no padding, which means that because this is a block cipher, it works on blocks of 128 bits. This scheme requires no padding because you just can stop at some bit and that's it. And what also it also does, it generates an authentication data. So this actually signs the data that was encrypted, which means that you can actually check for integrity problems and stuff like that. You do not need to have other MAC schemes and everything, just you can use this scheme to authenticate everything. And so, how this works? First, you generate a salt. Now, salting is extremely important, and anyone who has done a service that does authentication has an idea what a salt is. Basically, it's a unique value that does not repeat, which is public, and which you use to modify all your key generation and everything, so you do not get repeated keys. You do not repeat encryptions, you'll see it later. This is an example of how we generated for this service, but it's an example, it's not actually required to do it like this. Basically what we do is we get, we cannot just not put this in here, sorry. We get the date and time, we get some random, and we get the user's email. The idea is that if anyone tries to send very fast, clicking very fast, the same thing 10 times, he will not get the same salt. And which is important, because you use this to generate the key. Now, the password the user gives is not exactly useless, but it's cheap. Now, people are very bad at choosing passwords. They'll probably use the same password a lot, many times. It will probably be an easy password, stuff like that. So what will you, and this is really basic actually, that everybody does it like this. You use this PBKDF2, a password-based key derivation function. It took me, I think, 2 months to remember what exactly PBKDF means, and that is PBKDF, not PBDKF. But yeah, look it up in Wikipedia. It's a very simple construction that basically runs as many times you tell it, HMAC SHA-1 on the input password with the salt. So it runs HMAC, opens the salt, runs HMAC, opens the salt, 1600 times. And this results in a key that you can use for encryption, because this is now pretty random. It's has a bit set whenever it needs. And now the interesting thing here is that you can use the same password, for example ASDF, which is a password that a lot of people use. You can use the same password with, and every time the salt is different, the key will be different, which means that if you know, you cannot just know that this key results from this password. You don't have that kind of leak. Now, another thing, so 1600 times, we timed this, it takes about 100 milliseconds to generate. This prevents brute force attacks. It means that you cannot just generate, take a dictionary, generate all possible passwords with this salt, and get very, very fast the keys that you need to use to decrypt. It takes 100 milliseconds. Which means that if you needed a week to break a key, with this 16,000 times generation, you need 16,000 weeks, which seems like a good idea, seems okay. It still doesn't, so yeah, this is not going to say if your password is A, but it still helps. So, there are three things you can send to this service. There's a message, which you just encrypt like this. There's a file name. So, yeah, the file names are encrypted. So, not only the files, but also the file names are encrypted. Basically, what you do is, you get from the IV, from the salt, the first 96 bits. The last 32 bits are used as a block counter for the mode for the block cipher mode. And then you modify the first word. Now, this is a 32-bit word. You modify by XORing this with the number of file multiplied by 2, and you just do this. You just GCM it. And for the file itself, you do this almost the same thing. You do this, but this plus 1, which means that you're going to have different salts for the message, for the file, and for the file names every time. They're going to be modified just by a few bits, which is enough. And because of how browsers work, you have to encrypt all the files in blocks of 1 megabyte. So you have 1 megabyte of data, an authentication block, 1 megabyte of data, encryption, authentication block, like that. Now, yeah, to repeat like some stuff, we do salting because you do not leak if two files look the same or are the same. Because if the salt, the IV changes, it means that every time you encrypt a file with a different salt, it's a different output. So for example, if you have a file which starts with and then a file name that starts the same way, if you do encrypt it in this way, using this scheme, there, you're never going to see that, because they're going to encrypt two different things. It will not leak. Yeah, the 1 megabyte split is because the way browsers work, you cannot load the whole file in memory because it will crash on most browsers. We use GCM because, yeah, it's the authentication and no padding, and the XORs generate the difference in IV. So this weird thing, which is a very small and very simple operation, actually guarantees you the difference when you encrypt the files. And that's basically the service. It works very well. It works on most browsers. By most, I mean it doesn't work on old Internet Explorers. It does not, receiving files doesn't work on the iPhone's browser because it has no way to save a file. And these people are insane. And there's some problems with the Android's browser. It cannot send files, stuff like that. And I think you can see most of that, it's in the code. There's a browser detection there, which is extremely weird, and that works. I have no idea. Now, there's another fun thing we did, which is a peer-to-peer protocol. We needed this because we write the clients for our service, the client software. And at some points, so yeah, we're something like a Dropbox service, like a Dropbox, which but done properly, as I said. So what this does is it gives you a way to query the local network if somebody else has a some file that you need to download from the service. Because it would be almost always be faster to download something from the local network than to download it from the internet. So yeah, this gives you a way to copy files directly between users, and so both sides are untrusted. You do not know, you don't trust the sender, you don't trust the requester, and the network is easy to listen to practical purposes. Imagine you're working in a Wi-Fi network. Easy to listen Wi-Fi network. Or if somebody has used that, the coaxial Ethernet. Broadcast network, you can see everything on it, it's very easy to do it. It's easy to do manage the middle. This is the environment you have to, this works in. So, what we need to, the SHA-1 and size of the file for us are the unique identifier of the file. We have, this was a decision that, a trade-off. We think that this is enough to identify a file. And every client generates a key pair, which regenerates every 6 months, I think, which is used for the transfers later. So, now you cannot just ask, do you have this file, this SHA-1 checksum? Because you leak that. People would know that you're looking for this specific checksum. So, because we didn't know what a zero knowledge proof is, and because I still have no idea how to fit it in this scheme, we did this extremely nasty hack. So, you actually do not ask for the SHA-1, you say, these are the first 3 bytes of the SHA-1. This is the file size, this is a random, and the SHA-1 of the SHA ends in this random. Which means that all the clients have a database of all these checksums of the files they have. So they get, okay, they take all the files whose checksums start with this, and they can run the check if this matches with any of them. So nobody knows which file exactly are looking for except the people that already have this file. And this is broadcast and or multicast over the network. I mean, the IPv6 people hate the word broadcast, that it's not found anywhere, but it's broadcast. If you send it to all people that speak IPv6 in your network, it's broadcast. Get over it. So here we leak only the file size. Now, we probably don't need to send the file size. We discussed this with a friend a few hours ago. We probably don't need to send the file size. But that's not a very big leak. Now, here somebody receives a file, receives a request, and checks if there's a match anywhere. And what the receiver does, it binds to a port, if not already done, and binds to the socket and sends a port, some random, and the SHA-1 of the file, and the random. This is the proof that you actually have the file. And now, this is very important. We check if the both randoms are different, so you cannot just replay what you got sent. This is actually a basic challenge response attack and mutual challenge of response authentication. And there were a lot of schemes where people just replayed what got sent to them and were able to authenticate to anyone without knowing the password. So yeah. Now, this seems like the place to try man in the middle, but what we do afterwards, you ask the central service to give you. So you know you have the file somewhere in the local network. You ask the central service to give you a token that says you can have this file, you have access to this file. Now this is important because the remote site has no idea if you actually can have this file. Just knowledge of the checksum of the file is not enough. And you ask the central service, say to the central service, I want access to this file in my local network, this is my RSA key. And you get back a token which contains a signature of the key plus some other stuff. And this way, when you send this to the person that has the file, they can know that you have that they know that you have access to this file, and they know that this is your key. So whatever you do, there is no way somebody else in the middle can replace the key or do anything else. So what you do is just send the key, the token, the file. This again to identify the file because this is used to. Get which file it is, and you get, and then you just the remote site, the one that has the file, just generates some AS keys, encrypts them with your RSA key, sends the key, sends the file encrypted with the AS again, and that's it. You don't need we use basic counter mode here because we do not need the authentication that GCM provides. We already have the SHA-1 of the file, which is the integrity check, so we can go with it now. Some people ask, why do we do this? Why do we use AS here? Why don't we just use RSA? RSA is slow. Very, very, very slow. Most of the encryption algorithms, the public key encryption algorithms are slow. So all the implementations you're going to see, except one by Dan Burstein, generate session keys, which are used with some very fast symmetric algorithm. And using them, they encrypt all their data. Actually, if you use SSL, SSL does the same thing. All the encryption algorithms that do this, because, for example, AES is, I don't know what the word is, probably not extremely fast, but with the proper processor and instructions, you can do awesome 8 gigabytes per second. I think there's some paper by Intel that said, you can do AES without the instructions is 800 megabytes per second, AS with the instruction is about 10 gigabytes per second, which is sometimes faster than the bandwidth you have to the memory, which should be enough, I think. There are trade-offs in this. So we don't give away a lot, this is not right, we don't give away a lot of information. So you still know the first 3 bytes of the checksum, you know the size of the file. You know that anyway because you can see how much data was transferred. You cannot just steal files, you cannot sit in the middle and listen or eavesdrop on the files and get them. And now, the site that has the file, he has to check the token with the central service. He has to ask, is this token right? We could have done this with PKI, with public key cryptography, signing and everything. We decided that we can live with one more RTT to the service instead of having to run an insane infrastructure just for this. Because PKI is horrible. Now, there is a leak here, that, which means that if you have the SHA-1 of the file, if you know the checksum of the file, you can ask if anyone has this. Now, my attack model for this, the explanation why this is bad, doesn't sound that bad. It's mostly law enforcement know there's something bad in this file. They can go around in public networks and ask who has the file and then go and get the people. But yeah, people can find if you have specific files in our service, which is a problem in some way, but this is acceptable trade-off because they can ask us and we have nothing that we can do to prevent this. As I said, you should not trust us. Our marketing people would say something different, but they'll probably be lying. So all clients have an option to disable this. It's visible enough, you can just disable peer-to-peer and it won't be susceptible to this kind of attacks. But this helps a lot with some, if five people are working on the same file and just save it, it's very fast just to get the updated version of the file. So this is a trade-off between security and speed, and you have to live with it. And this is the encrypted file system. I don't know if this is the right term for it. It's a file system in user space on top of a remote file object storage, which people call the cloud and which is a word I hate. And a lot of people have begun to hate. So this is not finished. We've written a lot of it, but it's unfinished. Some of the stuff is not ready. We have some specifications for it. They're all in GitHub. There's weird code like this. This is constant memory comparison. This is extremely important. For example, why is this extremely important? If you use a basic string comparison function to compare passwords, it's a very bad example, but it works. You can time how long it takes for the system to check if the password is right. Now, you can try changing the first letter until it starts to take a bit longer to guess to check the password. Then you can try the second letter, the third letter, and you can just by the time it takes to check the password, find out what the password is. I think the same thing is done with locks, actually. It's very close to that. So you need to have constant functions that do the comparison, for example. There's constant mem copy, and for example, this is actually wrong, but I'm not going to tell what this does. But if you like puzzles, this is on line 420. You can look at it and try to see what it does and why is it wrong. You might need to compile it to assembly. Now, with the stuff itself, why don't we just use the same thing we used before, the GCM stuff? There's a problem. Anything encrypted with a counter mode, with the basic counter mode or the Galois counter mode, has a very nasty leak. The XOR of the unencrypted data is the same as the XOR of the encrypted data. Example, why is this very bad? You decide to use a file system image that you store on our services, and you make the image, encrypt it, store it. Now, everybody knows what an empty file image looks like, so we know this. We know the original data. We know the encrypted version of data because you just gave it to us. Then you change something and you give us this, the second version of the encrypted data. We solve this and we get what you actually put in your file system, which is bad, I think. And so it leaks very bad and it's acceptable to some replay attacks, which I'll talk about a bit later. And there are standards you can use. there's EncFS and there's the IEEE standard. And yeah, they're basically saying for replay attacks, sector randomization and traffic analysis, you're on your own. You have to think of something outside of the standard to handle this. And the EncFS audit that was done, I think, a year ago says, the audit finds that EncFS is not up to speed with modern cryptography practices. So we didn't have a lot of choice in this. And you'll see that we designed something extremely good. Now, this is very basic. Every user gets an RSA key pair, which they generate. That's very important. The user generates the key pair. They give us the public key and something that everybody doesn't, a lot of people don't like. They also encrypt their private key with a passphrase and store it and give it to us. They might not do this. I mean, this is a choice given to the user. It's not strictly required, but the thing is that if you have a key and you have 20 devices you want to use it on, you either have to move the key by yourself, which most people would be unable to do at all, because most people have no understanding of what a key is, which is part of the problem with using cryptography. And this gives you a way that you have to remember just a passphrase, a password, and you can just get your key from our service. And the only attack on this is dictionary attack, which is preventable by salts and stuff like that and by people thinking of not extremely stupid passwords. Anyway, so now for each file and the directory, we keep a key and an IV, so these are the session keys. And for them, we keep them encrypted with the user's public RSA key, which means that actually, yeah, the user does the encryption, we just keep them. Which this way, the user needs just one key that they need to keep, and with it they can access all of their stuff. Now, the file encryption is interesting. I've written which the functions are. Now, you split the file in 4 kilobyte sectors. This is close to what you do in block devices. You split them, and every sector is encrypted with CBC, which is the cipher blockchaining, which for a sector doesn't matter. With an IV with the authentication block for that sector, I will show in a minute what that means. So the file looks like this. You have data, which is 255 sectors. Then for each of them, you have 16 bytes, 128 bits of authentication data here. Then again, the same thing, and then authentication data. And then you have authentication data on all the authentication sectors. I'll show a bit later how this one is calculated. It's extremely interesting. Now, the authentication block, in the sector you have blocks for each sector, which is 128 bits, which is truncated HMAC SHA-1 of the data, the sector ID, and a revision. With the secret, that's the per file IV. Now, the revision, why do we have a revision here? If you have a file, you change a sector that's, for example, AAAA. Then change to BBBBB, and then again change it back to AAAA. With most schemes, it will encrypt to the same thing. You'll be able to see that it reverts to a previous version. With this thing in the mix, because it increases every time, you don't get that. It will encrypt to again to a different, this whole thing would change. And then because you use this to see the encryption, for an IV for the encryption, you will not, it will change everything. The revision itself is 3 bytes, which means that if you overflow it, you should rekey the file. And this is going to be, so if you do more than 16 million writes to a single sector, you will have to rekey the file, which means that at some point your write operation will become extremely slow. So for every 256 sectors, there's one sector with such authentication data, and it's encrypted with ECB, which means ECB is the stupidest way to encrypt, but it works in this case. ECB means just encrypt Every block with a key. No IVs, no chaining, nothing. Just encrypt. And this doesn't leak because this is sufficiently different that you cannot just have the same authentication block for two sectors. This is the point of it. If the data is the same, the sector is going to be different. The sector is always different and the revision just does some more changes. Now, the authentication data has the point of ensuring the integrity of the whole file. And it has to do it efficiently because the basic scheme that you just keep a very big SHA-1 checksum of the whole file and you update that on every change is insane because it means that on every write you have to recalculate this. And it's very, 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 very slow. So this is called a hash tree. You have the authentication data, you do hash on them, and on all of them you do again a hash when you get enough of them. And this can be, this is here at 3 levels, it can be 4, 5, depending on the size of the file. As much as the size grows, this can, but this is, the size of it is logarithmic, so I should have written that. But one read needs this amount of reads to verify the integrity. And this is also the height of the tree. This is the same thing that one read needs this amount of reads and this amount of writes, but for reading, these are going to be cached anyway. So most of the time, this is fast enough. You don't notice it, and for the writing, it's still not that much noticeable. You're not rewriting the whole file if you were using something like CBC or other stuff, and you still have the full file integrity. This is the file encryption. Now, we have the file name encryption, which has another problem. That you cannot have two files with the same file name in one directory. It's probably obvious why, I hope. which means that you need to have some kind of predictable encryption, which most cryptographers, when hear something like that, say, okay, this is not a good idea. So we have the per directory key and IV, and basically what we do is if the file name is less than a block size, we just directly encrypt it. It's not going to repeat. In the case of different file names. If the file names are the same, it would repeat, and we'll see that, and it will not allow you to have the same file with two files with the same name because you have to be able to access them in some way. Now, this is the fun part. If the file name is bigger, you get all the data after the first block, you do an HMAC on it with the directory IV, and you XOR this with the first block, and then you encrypt it. What this means is that any change in the file name is going to change the first block of the file name enough that if you encrypt this with the same key in the same way, if the file name is different in any way, it's going to look different, even if the files start with the same first block. Because if you just do CBC on the files, because you have the same IV, if they start with the same block, they'll encrypt to the same thing. You will actually be able to see that two files start with the same name. And people don't like that. So this is why we do this HMAC SHA-1 with the rest of the data, just to change some stuff in the beginning of the file name. And decryption, you just do the same thing. You just decrypt it, calculate this, and XOR, and restore the first block using XOR again. XOR is a great operation. Yeah, so two files in the same directory will have the same encrypted name, two blocks in the same file name will not have the same encrypted value, but and the first block repeated is not going to be the same. This is what we get with this scheme. Okay, so these were the three front problems. Now, we have stuff we haven't done yet. I should have had more slides for this part. But now, we don't have something that guarantees you that the whole snapshot of files and directories is consistent. Currently with this scheme, there's no connection between the directory and the files. That's cryptographically signed. And there's no connection between a directory and subdirectory. What should happen, and which is insane, is that on every change of a file, you should change also the directory, and all the directories are to the root to update that change, to be known that this was changed and this is a consistent snapshot. Which means that you're going to have a lot of writes, which is a problem for the service itself because it has to apply these writes, and it will be visible to the user. It's going to be too slow, which we don't want. Because, yeah, it has to be usable in some way. And if you make people a very secure and slow as hell service, they are not going to use it. They'll just try to disable it. This is the best example with this is you generate the generation of passwords for users. That you generate very strong, very hard passwords, and users just write them on a sticky note and put it on the monitor. Which, or under the keyboard, is the more secure version of that. And this will always happen. People will circumvent stuff that they don't like. So we have to think of this integrity. The other thing is a very, this is a very hard problem, actually. So we have sharing of files, which means that you can share your files, your directory with someone, and you can just work on the same files. Which is an extremely nice feature. You can do this with encrypted files. What you have to do is just get the other user's public key and re-encrypt all the session keys with that LSA key. It's very simple, it would work perfectly. The problem is, how do you get that key? Because you get it from us. Now, reminder again, Eastern European company with servers in the States. We can give you whatever key we want and say, this is your friend's key. And you have no idea, no way of knowing that this is actually his key. Now, there's the solutions for this. There are two solutions for this known in the world. One is called PKI. The other one is called Web of Trust. They both don't work in practice. The only solution we've gotten for this is that we get a neutral third party certification authority to handle that part. Yeah. It's the only idea we have until now, and fuck knows how we're going to solve this, but we're working on it. And in conclusion, cryptographic design sucks. There's a lot of stuff that breaks, very small mistake can break everything. It wasn't easy to design something that we cannot break. So it took us I can't remember how many months, just to find a design that we cannot think how to break. And I'm pretty much sure if I present this in enough conferences, people will find a way to break it. So this is the reason I'm presenting this here, actually. Please break it. Please. Because if I make something that I cannot break, I think that there should be something very, very wrong with it. That the same thing that you write a piece of code, it compiles and runs on the first tile.
Something's wrong.
Any questions?
I have one. You were talking about key generation. It's hard to brute force because it takes a certain amount of time.
The PBKDF?
Yeah, somewhere completely at the beginning. But that is assuming that generation of those keys is only serial. That it's not possible to parallel. Is it possible, for instance, to, let's say an agency has a botnet and they just fire away requests to the server or anywhere, that they can make it in parallel and then actually do still a dictionary attack that way?
Yes, you can parallelize the attack on this, but it's still going to work slower than non. It's not
that.
Perfect. I don't think there's a scheme that you cannot parallelize. So one calculation, one of these, you cannot run one of these in parallel. But you can run 10 of them in parallel with no problem. So
let's say 100,000.
Yeah. At the end of the day, you're still going to need 16,000 times more CPU time to calculate this. More power, which costs more,
I think the point here is this makes it harder for everyone.
Yeah, this makes it harder for them, also for us.
People with FPGAs, harder for them. People with botnets, it's harder for them too.
Any other question?
How do you track file changes on storage?
on which so on the client.
You must have the storage for where the files are kept, and if someone changed file, how do you know that somebody changed file?
So on the clients unauthorized. Yes. We don't also these things.
Oh, okay.
For the file system, for the last service. It's easy because if you break, if you change anything in the file, this is not going to be right. The authentication data is going to be different. It's going to be wrong. So this is a very simple integrity check, which we cannot do on our side, but the client can. Because the client, while decrypting, doing the reads, he reads also the authentication sectors and sees, okay, this block, the authentication of this, it should be this one. It's not. This is wrong. End of discussion. So you actually have integrity checks built in the file format, which the users can check. We cannot, if in some way we get a broken file, we cannot check that.
So if you have file corrupted and client downloads, he sees that something is wrong.
Yes.
But you don't know that file is corrupted.
Yes. Well, depends. We have checksums on our side, but for the purpose of the discussion, we can say that we might not know because we might be hacked by some very, very nasty three-letter agency. So the point of all this is that we are not trusted. And so all the good verifications are done in the client.
Just one question. I did not notice, but what kind of algorithm are you using for encrypting files? AES.
AES, yes.
And why don't you use XDS? It's regular.
Ah, no, it's here.
You know what? Why? You.
It says it over here. XDS is part of the EEE standard. And XTS has some insane stuff in it for padding schemes. So the padding scheme in XTS and some of the stuff is just not worth. So we took some stuff from XTS, some ideas, but we don't really see the point. XTS is a bit more complex than we need to. It has some very nice ideas, yes.
It is public, and it is verified by attacking and so on.
Not. There are a few papers on XTS which say some very nasty things. For example, that so for XTS, the standard says you need two keys, and some people, the author of XTS says no, you need one key. You read my paper wrong, for example, stuff like that. So I don't know how much XTS is used in practice, but there seems to be some very bad things in there. And CBC, what we use. CBC is extremely simple. What we use is extremely simple, so...
CBC?
Partially CBC, yes.
But...
Every sector is encrypted with CBC.
I will not use CBC for that because I'm...
One change changes the whole 4 kilobyte sector, yes. But this is a trade-off we are okay with because you rarely change just 2 bytes in the middle of the file. And this is like a block device. So.
But it's not mentioned to be used for that kind. So because of that, there is a lot of encryption file system using some algorithms. They are using terabytes and so on, and there are some well-known attacks on them. Now, if I use CBC like this, how can you guarantee me, like, I will use this or this? What if I put, let's say, more files in one directory, or more this or more this, and you use one key on that? It could be nasty.
No, we do not use the same key. This is very important. We do not repeat keys.
You repeat the key.
Yeah, every file and every directory have a separate so-called session key. This is not repeated. It's generated with. We have a function called generate strong random and generate weak random. We use the strong random to generate the keys for the file. So every file has a separate key and separate ID. You never use it.
I have one question. That means that you expose possibility to Pollard birthday attack. If you know.
Yes.
I can generate one key random from that and try to guess files in the system. If it's more files more sectors, more...
It's 256-bit key. Good luck with that. No, so the key is 256 bits and the IV is 128, so it's enough that we are not worried about the birthday attack. You can so just guessing the keys. We don't think that's a problem. It's like a good luck finding the right key for just by randomly.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Sorry, I forget one question for generating random key. What do you use? JavaScript.
And we don't have the for this part. We do not have this for JavaScript yet. So I have no idea what we're going to use in JavaScript. To be honest, we have this only in C, which works on Linux, Windows, and Mac, using the system stuff with. I can't remember. You have to check this also. But for JavaScript, we don't know. I mean, we have weak random in JavaScript we use for some other stuff, which comes from the Stanford JavaScript cryptographic library. But we do not use this to generate keys. And when we have to write this for the web for JavaScript, we're probably going to suffer very much. But right now, it's still not. We still haven't tackled that problem. I'm probably very much out of time, so thank you.